Good morning and welcome to this service of Holy Communion from St. Mary's in Sanderstead. Today marks the pivotal point in Matthew's Gospel as Jesus turns his focus towards Jerusalem and his ultimate death and resurrection. He calls his disciples to take up their cross and follow him. And the baptismal resonance of this echoes across the centuries, for we too are marked with the cross, and we too called to follow. Here is the offer of life in all its fullness, for to lose oneself in God is to find oneself anew, for through death comes the light of resurrection. We meet in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Together we pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. My sisters and brothers, as we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us first call to mind and confess our sin. God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners. We turn from the wrong that we have thought and said and done, and are mindful of all that we have failed to do. For the sake of Jesus who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
So let us pray. Almighty God, who called your church to bear witness that you were in Christ reconciling the world to yourself, help us to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be drawn to you through him who was lifted high upon the cross and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We're going to have our first reading.
A reading from Exodus, chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings. And I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come. I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, If I come to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, Thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, Thus you shall say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 105. Oh, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises and tell of all his marvelous works. Rejoice in the praise of his holy name. Let the hearts of them rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O seed of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen. Then Israel came into Egypt. Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham, and the Lord made his people exceedingly fruitful. He made them too many for their adversaries, whose heart he turned, so that they hated his people and dealt craftily with his servants. Then sent he Moses, his servant, and Aaron, whom he had chosen. that they might keep his statutes and faithfully observe his laws. Alleluia. A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, beginning at verse 9. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. No. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed and on the third day be raised. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you. But he turned and he said to Peter, Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what they have done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the coming of the Son of Man in his kingdom. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
These last months have been a strange time. Who could have imagined a year ago that the whole world would be put on hold because of a virus that is so contagious and so deadly that it would kill hundreds of thousands of people and change the lives of many others? For months, our lives have shrunk. We only feel truly safe within the confines of our homes, and for some, that is not a safe place either. When we venture out, we are careful not to get too close to anyone else. Masks have become as necessary as our keys and our phones. And then there is church, isn't there? It seems like a distant memory. That regular Sunday morning routine, hymn books and service leaflets, handshakes and hugs, singing and praying together. We look forward to next week when we'll be back together in person, at least some of us, and be allowed the bread, the body of Christ. But even then, there will still be restrictions. We dream of the time when we will be back to normal, passing the peace, singing our praise with gusto, receiving the wine, the precious blood, those holy moments. But as for today, as for the last long months, we have this. Worship mediated by a screen, gathering mediated by electrons. We've been reminded of how much of our faith is grounded in community. And it raises a question, doesn't it? What does it mean to be a Christian, a follower of Jesus, in a time when we can't worship together in person? It's a question that's new to most of us, because from the time of the early church, being a Christian has meant being part of a body. It's a metaphor that shows up repeatedly in Paul's letters. There's nothing existing that is just an individual Christian, independent of any other. We belong to one another, and that belonging is most clearly expressed when we worship together. Except we can't. Of course, if we think about it, we aren't the only people in the history of our faith who have had to ask that question. Think of the many over the centuries who, because of persecution, have been unable to meet together to worship. Their faith has had to be private, individual, not by choice, but because anything else was impossible. Or those, because of disability, have been unable to participate fully in our services. Or those who live too far away from a worshiping community to regularly come to church. For them, this has been the reality of their everyday faith. Our experience in this time is not unique, but is new to us. So what does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be church when we're isolated from each other? As I read the epistle for today, it seemed like this might just be the beginning of an answer. At first glance, it seems like a whole list of commands. But when you read it in the context of the letter to the Romans, it takes on a slightly different flavor. Because for the first 11 chapters, Paul's letter to the Romans seems fairly theoretical. It's a long argument about who is saved and how. But at the beginning of chapter 12, as we heard last week, the tone changes dramatically. Suddenly, Paul begins to talk about practicalities. If everything that he has said is true, if we really are saved by God's grace, then this, what he's about to write, is the difference it makes in our lives. And he begins this chapter I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. We are transformed by the saving grace of God, transformed by knowing Christ. And that transformation involves the whole of ourselves, our bodies, minds, and spirits. God in Christ will change our lives. And for the rest of the letter to the Romans, Paul explores what that might look like in practice. He's writing to people, both those from Jewish backgrounds and those who are converts from other religions, people who live in a city where gods and shrines are everywhere, and where your religious identity was defined by which shrine or thrones you chose to worship at. And which one you chose was likely to be related to what that God was likely to give you. But what Paul seems to be saying is that being Christian is about more than this. It's not about worshipping a God for the benefits you get, but worshipping this God who will change your life. And of course, the crucial question is, how will it change? We know from the final chapter of this letter to the Romans that Paul is writing it with the help of a scribe, Tertius, and that there are a bunch of other people around, Timothy, who he describes as his co-worker, and Phoebe, the deacon, and Lucius, and Jason, and Sosipater, his compatriots, and Gaius, his host, and Erastus and Quartus, prominent men in the city. And I just wonder if what we read in these last chapters of the letter to the Romans is not so much a list of commands from the mouth or pen of Paul as the result of a brainstorming session that he has with those nine, perhaps others hanging on as well. And so what we have is everyone's ideas of what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus, what it's like when God changes your life. Let love be genuine, begins Timothy. Hate what is evil, calls out Jason, and hold fast to what is good, says Lucius. Love one another with mutual affection, says Phoebe. Outdo one another in showing honour, says Gaius, having learned from watching Paul interact with the people in his home. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, chime in Sosipater and Quartus. Serve the Lord, adds Tertius, as he tries to keep up with all the ideas he's supposed to be scribbling down. And the suggestions keep coming. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, says Erastus, the city treasurer, who knows how to manage money, but also remembers the struggles the church in Jerusalem has been having. Extend hospitality to strangers, says Paul, because he's going to send this letter with Phoebe, who they've never met. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Brothers and sisters, if there is any time that we need this advice, it is now. There are beginning to be cracks in the unity that was created by the threat of COVID-19. People have become restive, sick and tired of the restrictions, and they're ready to get back to the life that they had before, even though it might mean putting others at risk. And this week, another black man was shot by police in the US. And we've been reminded these last months that racism is not something that happens only over there, but here as well. And no matter what our own particular experience is, there are people who are angry and damaged and hurting deeply. There is clear injustice in how our system works for so many. And then there's Brexit. Remember that? Which exposed such deep divisions in our country. And already that divisive rhetoric is coming back. We need all the wise advice that we can get from the Apostle Paul. Maybe it's been a gift at this time that we haven't been able to meet together in person, because it means we haven't been able to retreat to a faith that's simply limited to Sundays. The only way we have been able to live out of our faith is in our everyday lives, here and now. And it seems to me that Paul the Apostle has wide advice about what it looks like to live our faith out, not just during lockdown, but continuing as we come back to church in the coming weeks, and as we live as faithful Christians in the middle of a struggling world. So I invite you to think on what the Apostle Paul says today. If he asks you to add to that list about what it means for God to change your life, what would you add? Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good.
Together we say the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And so with faith and love and in union with Christ, let us offer our prayers before the throne of grace. Lord, immortal and infinite, and beyond all our imagining, we pray knowing that you are also closer to us than our hearts to our heads. Lord, you are the ruler of the infinite spaces, and yet out of your limitless love, you chose to be bound to the earth and all its people within the limits of body and time. So often we make your love too narrow, with false limits of our own. So please help us to look above the smallness of our vision and focus instead on the immensity of your grace and power that you have promised for those who are members of the body of Christ. Fill our hearts, we pray, with the desire to fix on whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, and whatsoever things are lovely, through your Son, our Saviour. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, may your church help to bring peace and reconciliation in this world. At times, such peace seems a distant dream, and we know we cannot be peacemakers relying on human strength alone. So many problems in our world seem incapable of resolution. But yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, and through your strength and mercy, we ask for a measure of your grace and peace that transcends all our understanding, peace that will guard our hearts and our minds. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, when we feel the desire to withdraw into our own little worlds, set our hearts on fire with love for you, so that we may see your face in the eyes of those we live amongst. Help us to be open to sharing our lives and all the blessings that you have given us with each other. We pray for those who are sick, those who are lonely, those who are fearful and anxious. We pray especially today for Alison Brewster and Kim Brown. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, when we ask you to deliver us from evil, we pray not so much for mercy in granting us success in our undertakings as finding the grasp of your hand in our failures. Not so much to be sheltered from all danger as to be fearless in facing them. Not so much for the removal of all pain as for the hearts to conquer it. We pray for the peace that comes with acceptance as we seek a haven under the shadow of your wings. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you. Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is your living Word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your glory forever, praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. And so as our Saviour has taught us, so we now pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. We give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Just a reminder that there are various services that happen throughout the week, both here at St Mary's and at St James in Riddlesdown. And so this afternoon at 3 o'clock, there is a said communion service at St James. And next week, the St Mary's Church will be open at 9:45 as usual for our patronal festival service. And there are enough chairs for those who regularly come to St Mary's to all be here. So please do wear your masks. We have Archdeacon Rosemary Mallett coming to preach for us, and there will be refreshments afterwards, all served outside and in a way that is safe. So I do hope that you will join us next week as we celebrate the Blessed Virgin Mary and her visit to her cousin Elizabeth. I'm sure most of you have really enjoyed Jane and Charlotte Kennedy singing throughout the lockdown on our weekly services. And just to let you know also that Charlotte and Jane will be here, and Charlotte's going to be singing Ave Maria during the administration of Holy Communion on Sunday. So please do come and share with them your appreciation of all that they have done in helping us in our worship. We're going to close our service this morning with our final hymn, We Love the Place, O God. The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.